I'm going to ask the question this evening, and I trust that we'll be able to provide an answer. Do children have guardian angels? And a passage, if not the passage, that is often used is here in Matthew chapter 18, verse 10, where the Lord Jesus Christ, he warns against despising one of these little ones. And then, of course, the Lord says that in heaven, their angels do always behold the face of my Father. What exactly is the Lord Jesus Christ here communicating? Is he suggesting that little children have guardian angels that supernaturally oversee their lives and provide some sort or some measure of protection and immunity from harm and from problems and so on and so forth? And of course, it's always important to understand what's happening in the context. Why is it that the Lord Jesus here is even talking about little ones? Of course, let's begin at verse 1. At the same time came the disciples unto Jesus, saying, "Who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?" And what you'll begin to see as you progress through the book of Matthew, there is this tension that begins to build among the disciples regarding, well, who is the greatest? If we go over to chapter 20, notice in chapter 20, we read there at verse 20, Matthew 20:20, "Then came to him the mother of Zebedee's children with her sons, worshiping him and desiring a certain thing of him. And he said unto her, What wilt thou? She saith unto him, Grant that these my two sons may sit, the one on the right hand and the other on the left, in thy kingdom. But Jesus answered and said, Ye know not what ye ask. Are ye able to drink of the cup that I shall drink of, and to be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with? They said unto him, We are able. And he said unto them, Ye shall drink indeed of my cup, and be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with. But to sit on my right hand and on my left is not mine to give, but it shall be given to them for whom it is prepared of my Father. And when the 10 heard it, they were moved with indignation against the two brethren." So just be mindful that the disciples aren't thinking clearly regarding the outworking of the kingdom of heaven, the characteristic of the kingdom of heaven. You have these disciples that have a worldly view of what greatness is. If you go back now to chapter 18, verse 1, again, the question is asked, who is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven? Embedded in the question is a worldly assumption. It's a worldly perspective that life is a competition. When you think about who's the greatest, all too often human nature certainly thinks that, well, the one who has the most, the one who possesses the most, the one who's the smartest, the one who's the most charismatic, the one who is most intelligent, they're the ones that are going to be viewed as great. So from a worldly perspective, sadly, people think that greatness really is the gaining of glory, the gaining of honor, the gaining of greatness. And what man does, obviously, is they'll do anything and everything to preserve it. Now, what Jesus is going to do, he is not going to reject the concept of greatness in the kingdom. Sometimes people get a little, kind of confused here. Jesus does not condemn them for thinking that there is such a thing as greatness in the kingdom. We'll look at a couple of verses, because there is an issue of being great and being least in the kingdom. So what the Lord Jesus is going to do here is, he's not rejecting the idea of greatness, but he's going to redefine what greatness is in the kingdom. And that is critically important. For example, if we go over to chapter 20 again, go back to Matthew chapter 20, because after the request, hey, can my two sons, sit with you there in the kingdom? So let's read verse 24 again, Matthew 20, verse 24. And when the 10 heard it, they were moved with indignation against the two brethren. So now notice what the Lord's going to do here. But Jesus called them unto him and said, ye know that the princes of the Gentiles exercise dominion over them, and they that are great exercise authority upon them. So the Lord's taking up the subject, right? These guys are saying, hey, can my son sit? The mother said, hey, can my son sit one on the right hand, one on the left hand? Obviously, or apparently, being seated immediately next to the king is a position of honor. It's an important position. And the word greatness is brought up again, but he's going to correct their misunderstanding. The Gentiles, they're the ones that will define greatness, according to verse 25, as exercising dominion over them. So the world's concept of greatness is exercising power and authority over other people. Jesus, he's going to redefine it. And in the kingdom, you're not going to be exercising power and authority in the way that the world exercises power and authority. Notice what he says there at verse 26, but it shall not be so among you. But whosoever will be great among you. You notice he doesn't say there is no such thing as greatness. There is such a thing as greatness in the kingdom, but it's defined according to heaven, not according to the world standard. Again, verse 26, but it shall not be so among you, but whosoever will be great among you, let him be your minister. A minister is one who serves. And whosoever will be chief among you, let him be your servant, even as the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister and to give his life a ransom for many. So you have the Lord Jesus, he's correcting this twisted view of what greatness is in the kingdom. If we go over to chapter 23, notice there chapter 23 and verse 11, but he that is greatest among you shall be your servant, and whosoever shall exalt himself shall be abased, and he that shall humble himself shall be what? Exalted. So going back to chapter 18, the world, and certainly as the Lord already we saw there in chapter 20, the world will use power and force and intimidation. They use threats to get people in line. And sadly, it truly is a type of competition. And of course, the world's idea of greatness is all too often motivated by greed, personal self-interest, power, self-glory, honor, so on and so forth. So what the Lord Jesus is now going to do, he, at verse 2, chapter 18, verse 2, and Jesus called a little child unto him and set him in the midst of them and said, verily I say unto you, except ye be converted. That's to be converted. What he's saying is, gentlemen, you better change the way you're thinking about what greatness is all about. You've got it all wrong. You've allowed the world viewpoint. You've allowed human philosophy to define what greatness is. To convert means you need to think differently about this. And how does the Lord emphasize the need to think clearly about what it means to be great in my kingdom? You better start thinking about serving and not exercising authority over others. So he takes, of course, a little child, right? And he takes that little child for the purpose of representing the characteristic, the trait that is sought in the kingdom. Verse 4, whosoever therefore shall humble himself as this little child, the same is greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Childlike faith, childlike dependency, childlike humility, childlike vulnerability, childlike innocence. That is what defines greatness in the kingdom. And it's a beautiful illustration. I mean, not just an illustration, but he takes that little child and he says, you, notice verse 6, but whosoever shall offend one of these little ones which believe in me. What we're going to begin to look at here is, wait a minute. The issue is, number one, you have to be like this little child. I mean, in what sense can someone now become, look there at verse 3 again, he said, verily I say unto you, except ye be converted and become as a little children. Well, to become a little child, yeah, it certainly does carry with it the idea of possessing the same characteristics, again, humility, innocence, vulnerability, dependence, and faith, and so on and so forth. But when we begin looking at what the little flock is all about, you, at that period of time, during the messianic ministry of Jesus Christ, the nation of Israel is being called to become little children. The language that Jesus Christ here is going to use is borrowed from the Old Testament. So, number one, when we ask the question, do children have guardian angels? And if you take verse 10 and you remove it from the immediate context, you're going to run into a lot of problems. What we first need to recognize is when he refers to the little ones in verse 10, he's referring to something far more than a preschooler, all right? He's talking about being a part of the little flock, being a part of this renewed Israel, this new Israel that is being called out of apostasy. And a number of times he talks about little children in verse 3. In verse 4, he talks about the little child. Verse 5, the little child. Verse 6, little ones. And then we already read verse 10, little ones. The language, it's taken out of the Old Testament. So instead of viewing verse 10 as a passage that supposedly proves children have guardian angels, we need to recognize the relationship that angels have with the nation of Israel, but what the angels, the type of relationship the angels have with the little ones of the believing remnant. It truly is a little flock. By the way, when we talk about, if you go real quick, Luke chapter 12, the language, little flock. Now the Lord, he's talking about little children. He talks about little ones. The title or the description of those who are by faith trusting in Messiah, Luke chapter 12, and notice there at verse 32, fear not, little flock. Now, think about that for a moment. Little flock. Little in what way? Number one, they're certainly little in number. I mean, you're not going to find the majority of Israel leaving the apostasy and receiving Jesus as Messiah. So First off, they're little numerically. And by the way, that's a concept you find all over the Old Testament, a remnant, a residue. So they're little in number. But secondly, they're also little in station and status. Little as in insignificant. Who exactly are they? So yeah, they're just sort of a small group in relationship to the nation at large, but they're also little as far as where their standing is. They're little in station. They're little in status. But they're also little in disposition, in spirit, and in attitude. They're not the peacock, proud-filled, arrogant type of personality. They're little in their spiritual humility. So when we come across the language little flock, it fits what the Lord is emphasizing in Matthew chapter 18. Listen, in the kingdom of heaven, you're going to need to convert. You got to rethink, gentlemen, what it means to be great. You better convert, and you have to become one of these little children. Well, the language is fascinating, because to enter into the kingdom of heaven, you have to become a little child, not a preschooler, not a biological 3 or 4 year old, okay? Let's go to the Old Testament, Zechariah, and then we'll go to the book of Isaiah. But Zechariah is a passage that just opens the floodgates of light regarding the use of the term little one, Zechariah chapter 13. And if we read verse 7, Zechariah chapter 13, verse 7, "Awake, O sword, against my shepherd, and against the band that is my fellow, saith the Lord of hosts. Smite the shepherd, and the sheep shall be scattered, and I will turn my hand," here we go, "upon the," who? "The little ones." Now, of course, this is a description of the crucifixion and what is happening to the Lord Jesus Christ and what God does in his wisdom. He smites the shepherd, and by doing so, provides protection against the little flock. By the way, scattering them is actually a good thing, lest they're going to be destroyed, becoming an object of Roman genocide and so on and so forth. But the point is this: smite the shepherd, the sheep shall be scattered, and I will turn my hand, the hand of protection, the hand of provision. What God is saying is, it's a good thing to scatter them. And now God says, I will turn my hand upon the little ones, not preschoolers, not biological children. We understand the term little ones is a reference to the little flock, a reference to that believing remnant. Isaiah chapter 8, if we go over to Isaiah chapter 8, and we read here, Isaiah chapter 8, and notice if we we should read verse 15, Isaiah chapter 8, and we'll start there at verse 18. Verse 15, "And many among them shall stumble and fall and be broken and be snared and be taken. Bind up the testimony, seal the law among my disciples, and I will wait upon the Lord that hideth his face from the house of Jacob, and I will look for him. Behold, I and the children whom the Lord hath given me are for signs and for wonders in Israel from the Lord of hosts, which dwelleth in Mount Zion." The description, the children whom the Lord hath given me. Now, there's a direct application to the disciples, but the view of from God regarding those who are part of what Messiah is doing. They're the children. They're the little ones. They're the little flock. Go to Luke chapter 10. Luke chapter 10. So the use of the little child as an object lesson, it portrays, it's a wonderful picture of the believing remnant. Luke chapter 10, and notice at verse 20, notwithstanding, in this rejoice not that the spirits are subject unto you, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven. In that hour, Jesus rejoiced in spirit and said, I thank thee, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that thou hast hid these things from the wise and prudent and hast revealed them unto babes. Again, you know, these aren't, you know, little infants in diapers. We understand that. The character of the believing remnant. He says that they're babes. They're not, weak in the faith, or but rather it's the spiritual childlike humility, that level of faith. Thou hast revealed them unto babes. Even so, Father, for so it seemed good in thy sight. Now I want you to know, go over to 1 Peter, and when you start reading the Hebrew epistles, we find that those labels are retained, interestingly enough. And 1 Peter chapter 2, 1 Peter chapter 2, and I just want to check over here. 1 Peter chapter 2, notice there at verse 13. 1 Peter chapter 2, and that is not the verse. Is it 2 Peter? Oh, no. I'm sorry. Maybe it is 2 Peter. Oh, I am sorry. I did not write down the correct passage. That's okay. Go to 1 John. Go to 1 John. My apologies. 1 John and 1 John chapter 2. And notice throughout 1 John, John uses this. Reference uses the language, verse 1, chapter 2, verse 1, my little children. And we can go through all of the verses over and over again. You find the book of 1 John, 2 John, 3 John, referring to the believing remnant as little children. So it is language that is consistently used in reference to this called out remnant, the little flock. Now let's go back to Matthew chapter 18. Matthew chapter 18. And again, just so that we understand what's happening here in the context. So first of all, you have to become a little one. And you do so by believing who Jesus Christ is as the Messiah. And then there's some things that Jesus is going to say in warning those who would despise the little ones. So when verse 10 talks about the angels, we begin to recognize that the Lord is issuing some warnings against the improper treatment of the little ones. In chapter 18, we read at verse 6, but whosoever shall offend one of these little ones which believe in me, it were better for him that a millstone were hanged about his neck and that he were drowned in the depth of the sea. There's that sea again. The Lord, he warns about the sea. In Matthew, he talks about removing a mountain and casting it into the sea. In Luke, he talks about removing a sycamine tree and planting it in the sea. Here, the warning against offending a member of the little flock is, hey, you know, there's an issue of drowning in the sea. And again, there's something about this sea. But verse 6, how or in what way can someone offend one of these little ones? Now, to offend, if we go to Romans chapter 14, we can learn what it means to offend. Offend, it isn't merely hurting somebody's feeling. To offend someone isn't restricted to, saying something that would embarrass or, shame someone. In Romans chapter 14, we see how that word offend is used. You notice there at chapter 14 and verse 20. Let's pick it up at verse 15. But if thy brother be grieved with thy meat, now walkest thou not charitably, destroy not him with thy meat for whom Christ died. Now drop down to verse 20. For meat destroy not the work of God. All things indeed are pure, but it is evil for that man who eateth with offense. It is good neither to eat flesh, nor to drink wine, nor anything whereby thy brother stumbleth or is offended or is made weak. So to offend carries with it the idea of causing someone to stumble. It carries with it the idea of being made weak. It carries the idea of destroying him. Now, to offend, to lead a little one, to lead a member of the little flock, to stumble and to be made weak and to be destroyed. See, the warning that the Lord Jesus is issuing, and then eventually he's going to say something about the angels. Okay, you're going to have members of the little flock, the little ones. Watch out. If anyone in the outer camp, if an outsider comes in and seeks to offend, that is, to lead one of the little ones to stumble in their faith, to stumble in their understanding, which results in them being made weak and potentially destroying their edification. Not destroyed in a physical sense, but destroyed in their edification. Jesus says it's better to have a millstone cast around your neck and to be tossed into the depth of the sea. That is, why don't we go there to Matthew 18 again. In fact, notice how he's going to intensify the warning against deceiving, and that's what we're going to be looking at. To offend means to launch a campaign of deception for the purpose of destroying the little flock. It's going to fit what's going to happen in the tribulational period. In Matthew 18, he talks about anyone who tries to offend in verse 6. Look at verse 7. Woe unto the world because of offenses, for it must needs be that offenses come. But woe to that man by whom the offense cometh. That's a pretty serious warning here. He's warning the individual who is out there deliberately seeking to destroy members of the little flock. Verse 8, wherefore, if thy hand or thy foot offend thee, cut them off and cast them from thee. It is better for thee to enter into life halt or maimed rather than having two hands or two feet to be cast into everlasting fire. And if thine eye offend thee, pluck it out, cast it from thee. It is better for thee to enter into life with one eye rather than having two eyes to be cast into hellfire. That is not a warning to believers. That isn't a threat to a believer, but rather it's a warning to those who are out there trying to destroy the little flock by offending, by causing them to stumble. Now, in what, where would this happen? Let's go back to 2 Peter. In 2 Peter, we again, as Peter will identify the little flock, he is going to warn the little flock of the attempt to seduce them. Chapter 2, 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 1, "But there were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you, who privily shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that bought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. And many shall follow their pernicious ways, by reason of whom the way of truth shall be evil spoken of, and through covetousness shall they with feigned words make merchandise," here we go, "of you, whose judgment now of a long time lingereth not, and their damnation slumbereth not." So we're not going to go there. Peter, 1 John, they issue warnings. Little flock, little children, be aware. There's this campaign of deception out there for the purpose of seducing you. And they're going to make merchandise of you. So the attempt there is going to cause them, or the attempt will be to cause them to stumble, to be destroyed in their edification, to be destroyed in their understanding. Just a couple of verses. Go to 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2, and notice verse 18, "Little children, it is the last time. And as ye have heard that Antichrist shall come, even now are there many Antichrists, whereby we know that it is the last time. They went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would no doubt have continued with us, but they went out that they might be made manifest that they were not of us." You have this Antichrist system that is out there. And what John is going to do, of course, drop down to verse 24, "Let that therefore abide in you, which ye have heard from the beginning. If that which ye have heard from the beginning shall remain in you, ye also shall continue in the Son and in the Father." So be mindful, there will be the effort to offend the little ones, going back to Matthew chapter 18. All right, so we have a context now. The little ones are a description of the little flock and the attempt to offend. It's the attempt to destroy their faith, okay? By the way, you can't destroy them in the spiritual sense. That is, they're going to end up going to hell or anything like that. But rather, there's going to be the attempt to destroy their faith. With that, verse 10, "Take heed that ye despise not one of these little ones. For I say unto you that in heaven their angels do always behold the face of my Father which is in heaven." So now the Lord, again, warning. This is a warning against those that are going to offend. Here's the warning. You're better off cutting off your hand. You're better off plucking out your eyeballs. So Jesus isn't advocating amputation in the kingdom or anything like that. This is a warning against those who would assault the little ones. Then he says, don't despise them. And he says, their angels behold the face of my Father. That is an interesting expression here. In the Old Testament, of course, there is this connection, this relationship between angels and the nation of Israel. There has always been a very special connection between angels and the nation of Israel. And so, too, there continues to be a relationship between angels and the believing remnant, the little flock, the little ones. So Jesus, he's warning the apostates that are seeking to destroy his people. He says something about beholding the face of my Father. And that's an interesting expression. We find something similar in the book of Esther. And if you turn back to the book of Esther, we find a similar passage. I mean, the Lord doesn't say, hey, the angels are going to come get you. He adds, these angels behold the face of my Father. And that's kind of an odd expression here. What does that mean? These angels are beholding his face. Esther chapter 1. And in the context, verse 13, then the king said to the wise men, which knew the times, for so was the king's manner toward all that knew law and judgment. And the next, now here we go, and the, so these are the wise men, all right? These are special members of the king's cabinet, all right? Well, for lack of a better word. These are his confidants. Verse 14, and the next unto him was Karshina, Shethar, Admatha, Tarshish, Mersees, Marcena, and Memucan. Here we go. The seven princes of Persia and Media, which saw the king's face. Do you notice that they saw the king's face? What that is communicating is these seven counselors, these seven wise men, these were handpicked, select men that had a real intimate relationship with the king. They saw, they had access to the king. They understood the issues of governance by the king. They were members of the decision-making council, if you will. And so what the king does is he is going to consult with members of his close cabinet, and they which saw the king's face and which sat the first in the kingdom. So the use of that language, to see the king's face, it has something to do with having this access, having this privileged position, being seated, as that verse tells us, first in the kingdom. They have an extremely high position of governmental power and authority. And really, what's beautiful here is he said to the wise men, he's asking for advice. He's looking for counsel. So the point here is this. There is this interaction. There is this relationship. When the Lord Jesus, in warning anyone who would offend and despise and seek to deceive and to seek to destroy my little flock, he's warning them that there are these angels that have an intimate, direct relationship with God the Father. These are no ordinary angels that are, you know, just sitting camped out and observing. They're participating. To behold the face of the Father, it isn't merely I see him visibly at a distance. It carries with it this privileged place of participating in the outworking of the counsel of God. And they're participating in it. Now, we do know something about the relationship between angels and the nation of Israel. Before we go to the Old Testament, let's first go over to Revelation chapter 3, because here's another verse that it parallels what we read in Matthew chapter 18, verse 10. In Revelation chapter 3, verse 5, Revelation 3, verse 5, he that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. Now, the his angels can take you back to not blotting out his name, that is, the individual that overcometh. It could be referenced to the overcomer, the angels, or the overcomer's angels, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. Is it a reference to the Father? Is it the Father's angels, or is it the overcomer's angels? Well, Matthew chapter 18, verse 10, it indicates that these are the little flock's angels. But the point is, those angels are there when Messiah is going to confess something. There's something special going on here. There is a core of angels that are there that are going to testify. They're going to bear record. They're going to affirm the confession that the Lord Jesus Christ is making to the Father in relationship to the believing remnant, now in this specific context, the overcomer. Why the need to have angels there listening to the confession? If we once again think about this special core of angels that are participating in this outworking, in this participation in what it is God is doing, the counsel of God, which is being carried out. So there's something just very special about these angels in relationship to all that. Now, the Lord, of course, he's going to say some things about these angels. Let's go back to Matthew chapter 13, and then we're going to go back to the book of Psalms. The book of Psalms will say some fascinating things. Matthew chapter 13 and verse 39. Matthew 13, verse 39, the enemy that sowed them is the devil, the harvest is the end of the world, and the reapers are the angels. And if we drop down to verse 49, we read there, so shall it be at the end of the world, the angels shall come forth and sever the wicked from among the just, and shall cast them into the furnace of fire. There shall be wailing and gnashing of teeth. So we do see that angels are agents of judgment. Angels are agents of divine judgment. They're going to be utilized in rescuing the elect and at the same time carrying out judgment. Now go to Psalms. And notice some of the passages here. Psalms chapter 68. Psalms chapter 68. And just, again, the relationship, angels and Israel. Psalms chapter 68, verse 17. The chariots of God are 20,000, even thousands of angels. The Lord is among them, as in Sinai, in the holy place. Thousands of angels. Go over to 2 Kings. You see the thousands, well, in this case, chariots of God are 20,000, even thousands of angels. In 2 Kings chapter 6, notice that verse 17. 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 17. And Elijah prayed and said, Lord, I pray thee, open his eyes that he may see. And the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw, and behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of what? Fire round about Elisha. There are angels, and they're not visible, but they're there. When considering Israel's history, you find angels are involved in their national identity. In fact, no sooner did God lead them out from Egypt through the Red Sea, and we find out that God commissions an angel to lead Israel into the land of Canaan. There was an angel that was there leading Israel into the land of Canaan. Go back, go to Psalms chapter 78. Psalms chapter 78. Psalms 78, verse 49. Psalms chapter 78, verse 49. And of course, this is recounting, this chapter is recounting the deliverance of Israel out of Egypt and the plagues in Egypt. But verse 49, he cast upon them the fierceness of his anger, wrath, and indignation and trouble by sending evil angels among them. Now, these are not fallen angels. They're not evil morally. These are angels that are perpetrating. These are angels that are causing evil. They're causing calamity. So here's the point. When God judges and when God meets vengeance, when his anger, his wrath, indignation, you find angels that are there. Whether it's the chariots of fire, go over to chapter 104, Psalms chapter 104. And notice Psalms 104 and verse 4. Who maketh his angels spirits, his ministers a flaming what? Fire. What Jesus is talking about is the impending wrath of God that's going to be poured out definitely at the second coming, because it is going to be at the second coming that Jesus is bringing these angels. Go over to 2 Thessalonians. Of course, Paul, he comments on that. 2 Thessalonians and chapter 1. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1. And notice there at verse 7. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 7. And to you who are troubled, rest with us when the Lord Jesus shall be revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God and that obey not the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power. Angels. Matthew chapter 24 also describes how the Son of Man, he's coming back in power and in great glory. The angels, they are agents of divine justice. And that's what the Lord Jesus Christ is warning against there in Matthew chapter 18. Unfortunately, there's a lot of sentimentality. There's a lot of, you know, mythology, a lot of wives' fables, a lot of legends, a lot of myths regarding how every little child has an individual personal angel that is assigned to them. And that's just fallacy. That's fiction. When the Lord Jesus is, again, we compare verses with verses, and now we can paint a complete picture. Jesus is saying, listen, you, if you're going to try to destroy and despise and offend my little flock, you're going to be the subject of this angelic attack, if you will, the angelic wrath that God is using. Justice, judgment, and punishment is going to be meted out by those entities. Father, again, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your love. We thank you for your word. And we thank you in Christ's name. Amen.